Wisdom, a protector, shelter, comfort. Hallelujah. Nobody like our God. Who is this King of glory? The Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle. Hallelujah. I need the Lord. How about you? I want God to come in and dwell and stay in this temple. Hallelujah. Let's just lift him up this morning. Let's just lift up a praise, a thanks. Hallelujah. Of thanksgiving this morning. Let him hear your thanks. Let him hear your adoration today. For he's worthy to be praised. He is the King of glory. He is the King of kings and the Lord of lords. And he is deserving of a praise today. Thank you, Lord, for being there for me. Thank you, Lord, for never forsaking me. Thank you, Lord, for being my peace when I needed it. Thank you, Lord, for being my healer when I was sick in my body. Thank you, Lord, for all that you are. Oh, we love you, we love you, we love you, yes. Hallelujah, just let it come from your lips this morning, for he is worthy. If I had 10,000 tongues, it wouldn't be enough to give him glory, hallelujah. Is anybody ready for praise and worship today? We want the King of glory to come in, amen, hallelujah. Let's lift him up, hallelujah, Jesus. Let me hear you clap those hands. Lord of Lords, declaring that he is the King of glory this morning. Hallelujah. in reverence of his name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You are great and greatly to be praised. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You deserve the glory and the honor. We lift our hands in worship as we bless your holy name. You deserve the glory and the honor. We lift our hands in worship as we bless your holy name. For you are
Well, this is the day the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. Any glad people in the room today? Just glad to see another Sunday. Glad you made it another week. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. I'm not trying to make you selfish, but just look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, tell him, I don't know what you come to do, but I come to clap my hands. Tell him, I come to give him praise. Tell him, I come to do my dance. Find somebody on the other side and say, neighbor, I don't know what you come to do, but I come to give God a praise. Now don't talk about it, be about it. Take about 20 seconds and give God a praise right here. He's been too good to look cute. He's been too good to just stand here. He's been better to me than I've been to myself. Is there anybody in the room that says, thank God I don't look like what I've been through? You see my glory, but you don't know my story? Tell them I've been through the fire and still don't smell like smoke. Shake your neighbor's hand and say, neighbor, I'm a walking miracle. If you only knew what God is still doing for me, you'd be shouting for me. Don't let the good clothes fool you. Don't let the dress fool you. Don't let the wig fool you. I snatch this thing off and give God a praise. I thank God that he's still God. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. I will bless the Lord at all times. His praises shall continually be in my mouth. Where the praise is at? Where the praise is at? Think of one thing God has done for you and just give God a praise. We better move on, because I know how 11 o'clock can get. We better move on, because I know how the 11 o'clock service can get. We show up trying to be cool, calm, and collected. The problem is, in this service, they give us too much time to think. I can't have a whole lot of time to think, because every time I start thinking, I think of the goodness. Oh, you got the same problem? Here's the problem. When I think of the goodness of Jesus and all he's done for me, cute goes out the window. My soul cries out, hallelujah. I just got a quick question. Has God been good to anybody in here? Has he kept anybody in here? Wait a minute. I got another question for you. Won't he do it? Won't he bring you out? Won't he make a way? Won't he turn it around? Won't he pick you up? Won't he deliver you? Won't he protect you? Won't he do it? Won't he, won't he, won't he? Won't he, won't he, won't he? Won't he, won't he, won't he? Oh. I'm sorry. I'm sorry. I told myself in the back I was gonna come out here with some manners. And I'm gonna behave myself. But when I think of how good God has been, I said, when I think of how good God has been, I'm gonna move on, y'all. But can we take about 20 seconds and just think of how good God has been on this Palm Sunday and give God a praise? I said I was gonna be cool. For some of you, I know your story. I know your testimony. I know what you've been through. And I'm telling you, you don't look like what you've been through. And you owe God a praise, because he's been better to you than you've been to yourself. I don't need everybody, but just give me about 600 people that know you a walking testimony to just praise God for about 20 seconds and make the devil real mad, to let him know that you've already made up in your mind that you will bless the Lord at all times and his praises shall continue. I got one lady. I need somebody else to help me praise God. I need somebody else to act like you're in the room by yourself. There's my dude right there. I need somebody to act like you're in the room by yourself and give God a praise. Now it sounds like Hope City. You're still giving recovery. You're still resetting things. Father, we thank you that you're still God. You're God and you're God all by yourself. Now, Father, have your way in this service. Deliver in this service. Set free in this service. Heal in this service. Get breakthrough in this service. Connect people to your spirit in this service. Don't let anybody leave the same way they showed up. Let everybody leave better, stronger, and wiser, whether we're in person or online. Don't let anybody leave or log off the same way they showed up or logged on. But let everybody leave better. In the name of Jesus, I speak joy into the room, healing into the room, breakthrough into the room, deliverance into the room, restoration into the room, forgiveness into the room, reconciliation into the room. I bind the hand of the enemy. Anything that would try to cause a distraction, anything that would try to hinder the move of God, anything that would try to come against God, I bind it, I cast it down, I slice the head off of it. I cast it back to the pit of hell. I call it canceled, null, void, defeated, destroyed, dead, gone, overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. I speak victory over it in the name of Jesus. Victory in this house, healing in this house, joy in this house, breakthrough in this house. We will never be the same again. It's a life-changing service. We won't leave here the same way that we showed up. I'm releasing my pain. I'm releasing my hurt. I'm releasing my struggles. And I'm walking in the newness of life. I'm walking in the freedom of Christ. I'm walking delivered. I'm walking with my head held high. I'm walking with a smile on my face, with a praise in my mouth, with shouting in my feet. I'll never be the same again. On this Palm Sunday, it's Deliverance Sunday, it's Healing Sunday, it's Breakthrough Sunday, it's Break Free Sunday, it's Breakthrough Sunday, it's Breakout Sunday. This Sunday, and God is turning things around. God is restoring things. God is resetting things. And you'll never be the same again. In the name to which every knee shall bow, and every tongue shall confess. In the name of Jesus, somebody shout amen. Let that hand go. Put those hands together and give God a praise. and nobody has smiled at them, hugged them, loved on them. I don't ever want people to come to church and feel ignored, condemned, punished, or like they're by themselves. Would you go and find three people and act like an extension of Jesus Christ? Give them a hug and tell them it's already all right. It's already all right. Tell them it's already all right. Started shouting. I said, go hug them. I said, go hug. Y'all done grouped up and just started. I'm like, those weren't the instructions. It's good to see y'all. And it's good to see you. Thank you. It's good to see you on a day like today when they talking about the weather going to get crazy. At what time is it? It's 11:28. I think they said it like one. What time? At 5. Oh, we good. Because I plan to be gone by 4:30, so we're good. I just want, you know, I love the snow. But enough already. I mean, I get it. You know how to snow. But spring, it's like spring ain't even trying. Fight back, spring. You letting winter just hit you in the gut? Fight back. I'm excited about this week. So today is Palm Sunday, and they call it Palm Sunday because while some threw their clothes on the road as Jesus took his last journey into Jerusalem on the way to the cross, some grabbed branches off of palm trees, and they threw those in the road to worship. And that's why we call it Palm Sunday, because it signifies the last day that Jesus rode into Jerusalem, the last time, rather, he rode into Jerusalem before going to the cross. The week between Palm Sunday, which is today, and Resurrection Sunday, which is next Sunday, is called Passion Week. Passion Week. And so something happened every day of the week. That Monday through Friday, particularly Saturday, they call it Silent Saturday. Silent Saturday because everything just went quiet on that Saturday. In many ways, I guess you could say it was the calm before the storm. But it was Silent Saturday. But something happened every day of the week. I'm particularly excited this morning because we have this week our first ever Easter play coming this week. Resurrection play, Passion play. And there's two, and Pastor Tamara, she does a much better job than me talking about it. But they're going to do three shows, actually, this Friday at 7 p.m. and then Saturday at 2 p.m. and 7 p.m. They're going to do those shows. But I asked Pastor Chris Ford, I said, can y'all hurry up and put some your play clothes on and come and show the service just a sneak peek of what it looks like. And they did that at the 9 o'clock service. And I said, well, keep your play clothes on and show the people the 11 o'clock service. Keep in mind, this is not the lighting. There's play lighting that we have and the set and all of that. And the set is phenomenal. I think the thing I'm most excited about is that the play is right here too. So we're not going anywhere else. It's right here. But wait until you see, they're not gonna show you this today, but wait until you see the scene in the play where Peter's walking on water. I still don't know how they pulled that off. And he begins to sink and Jesus pulls it. Wait till you see it. But I said, don't show them that part, but show them just a little bit of teaser of what the play is like. So would you help me thank God and welcome our drama ministry as they come just to show you a teaser. Look at your neighbor and say, it's just a teaser.
do you know where I am? Could you help me get... This is beautiful, but I'm looking for... This looks great, but I'm lost. Do you know how I can get to... Wow, this is great. I'm looking for... Do you know... Can you help me? It's my jacket.
Tell you, unless you change and become like one of these children, you will not get into the kingdom of heaven. Children, shall we go?
Let's go.
Hey, have you guys heard the story of the wise men?
Can you tell me how I got here?
Jesus, he's gonna tell us.
Man, is that not phenomenal or what? Give it up for the drama ministry. I'm just amazed because I remember when we made the announcement that, hey, y'all, we want to start a drama ministry. And y'all was looking like how y'all looking right now. So I didn't know who was going to sign up. And then to see the phenomenal job that they did for Christmas, and it seems like they done kicked it up a whole bunch of notches. For Easter, I celebrate and I thank God for our drama team and our drama ministry. I'll talk more in a second, but would you help me thank God for Pastor Tamara Saunders as she comes at this time?
Good morning. Happy Sunday, everybody. Aren't you so excited about the Easter production? Oh my gosh, it's going to be amazing. Hope City Church of Colorado Performing Arts Ministry invites you to attend our very first Easter production titled Reflections, Echoes of the Cross. This is a live Broadway-style stage production featuring live music, dance, visual effects, amazing lighting, and the greatest story ever told, the death and the resurrection of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Praise the Lord. Come and experience this free Easter production. It begins this Friday. Someone say this Friday. At 7 p.m. right here in the auditorium, and again this Saturday at 2 p.m. and 7 p.m. right here in the auditorium. Please invite all of your family and your friends. It's your time to invite those coworkers and those neighbors and let them know they can join us for one of three Easter performances. And then please also note that on Sunday, this coming Sunday, Resurrection Sunday, we will have three services. Our service times are 8 a.m., 9:30 a.m., and 11:30 a.m. And we're so excited. Please mark your calendars and plan to attend our very first anniversary celebration gala dinner, which is Sunday, April the 21st at 6 p.m. This event will be held at the Hyatt Regency Aurora Denver Conference Center, and it features a delicious three-course plated dinner with your choice of entree. And this event is hosted by actor-comedian Flex Alexander, a live concert by Shawnice Wilson, and DJ Jeb will be playing music all night long to keep the party going. Tickets are only $85, and this includes your parking for that evening. Get your tickets now before they sell out. People are already buying. We've sold hundreds of tickets already. You can get your ticket right now. You can go to our website, hopecitycolorado.com, and you click on the gala celebration banner, or you can go out to the foyer after service to the gala ticket table. They would be happy to sell you a ticket or answer any questions that you might have. The Mile High United Way is partnering with local organizations to offer free, high-quality tax preparation services for Colorado households who in 2023 their income was $64,000 or less. They will prepare your taxes for free. You can go to taxhelpco.org for more information or to sign up. taxhelpco.org. The Winter Circle Support Group, hosted by Pastor Dave Whitmore, they meet every Monday evening at 6 p.m., and tomorrow's meeting is at the Central Recreation Center, which is located at 18150 East Vassar Place. This is a Bible-based support group, and they focus on providing tools needed to help you to continue to overcome and have victory over any cycles or habits that are keeping you from being God's best. And for those that are unavailable to attend in person, there is a Zoom option. To get that Zoom link, you just join the Winter Circle group via the Church Center app, or you can get that from the information desk in the foyer. If you or someone you know has a VA disability question or would like assistance in filing a VA disability claim, you can call the church office and schedule a meeting with Minister Cynthia Francis. And Hope City, we partnered with the Caring and Sharing Food Pantry. If you or someone you know is in need of food or any other resources, please call the church office at 303-361-7007. And if you'd like to become a member of this amazing church, there are two ways you can do that. You can go to our website, which is hopecitycolorado.com. You click on membership. You can fill out a form there. Or you can go out to our membership table. You can fill out a membership card there. And then we'll let you know what our next new members orientation class is. And if you've already attended one of our last orientation classes, you can also go to the new members table and pick up your membership certificate there. And we're always so excited about our two service times. Options every Sunday morning at 9 and 11 a.m. Can y'all make some noise? And it's always our pleasure to invite you to our pre-service receptions, which begin about 30 minutes before each service. So invite your family and your friends, join us for a time of hospitality in the foyer, and then come on into service. And then our amazing prayer teams, they are available for you every Sunday morning after each service, and they would love to touch and agree with you over any prayer needs that you might have. Also, throughout the week, you can submit those prayer requests online 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. They are interceding over those prayer requests. And then also, join us every Tuesday evening at 7 p.m. for Hope City Prayer Circle live on Facebook. Stay connected to our website, hopecitycolorado.com, our Facebook and our Instagram pages. Throughout the week, we're updating those with all the information, all things Hope City, Colorado. And if you've not already done so, take a moment and share this live stream. We're streaming live right now from our Facebook page. We're streaming live from our YouTube channel, and we are streaming live from our website. There are many ways that you can sow into this amazing church. And during the offering portion of today's service, one of our amazing ushers can give you an offering envelope. Or you can download the app that I use. It's a free app. You download it one time. It's called Givelify. You can set it up and you can sow into the church anytime the Lord is increasing you. Or we also have an official Cash App, an official Venmo. You just search for Hope City, Colorado. Or you can also give through our Square link on our website. Or you can mail those gifts in. Just make sure you're mailing those into our mailing address, which is also listed on our website. You know, and it's always our pleasure to welcome our first-time guest. If it's your first time streaming with us, we just wanted to say welcome and thank you. Send us a quick email to info@hopecitycolorado.com because we'd love to stay in contact with you. But if you'd help me welcome our first-time in-person guest, will you help me welcome Miss Jackie Aguilar, Rhonda and Julian Quintones, Lorraine Bearfield, Jada Lennon, Karen Engel, John and Lawrence Bearfield, Ashley Bingham, keep clapping, I have a lot of cards, Earl McNair, Aya Flowers, Sophia Austin, Ayala Evans, Katrina and James Moore, Lisa Watson, LaShonda Weston, Bob Ilaga, Terry Gant, Tina Arrows from Houston, Texas, Daphne from Toronto, Canada, and Reneva from Toronto, Canada. If I didn't say your name and it's your first time here, it's only because I didn't get a first-time guest card, but you can still go out to our first-time guest table. You can fill out that first-time guest card. They would love to give you a first-time guest gift, and it'll give us an opportunity to welcome you in a more personal way this week. But all my Hope City family, help me thank God one more time for all of our first-time guests. God bless you.
Wow. We celebrate. We thank God for all of you. First time from Canada, all the way from Canada. God bless you. Listen, I don't take for granted that you're here because it's not like you didn't have options. We're not the only church here. I think we're the best church here, but we're not the only. That just so y'all know, that little joke cost me 3 more emails. Just so y'all know. But you have options. You have options, and so we don't take it for granted. What we do know, and what I want you to know, is that every week we pray that God will send us first-time guests. And every week, He chooses who He wants. And so you are His answer to our prayers. So you're not here because you just chose to be here. You're here because you heard the voice of the Lord say, go to Hope City this Sunday. And so we celebrate and thank God for you being here this morning. Where's Gerard? Gerard, you back there? Gerard he's playing Jesus in the play. And we prayed for him at the 9 a.m. service, but I remember when he was cast as Jesus in the play, he was like, Pastor, pray for me. I'm nervous and pray. But he's doing a phenomenal job. Phenomenal job. One day we should do the Hope City Awards and just in the category of Best Jesus. And I got to tell you, you look more like what the Bible describes as Jesus than other Jesuses that I see out there. All right. Play with me if you want to. But here's why I want to pray for him, because, and especially everybody in the play, everybody, the whole cast and the crew, those behind the scenes, because I know whenever you get serious about volunteering for the Lord, the devil gets so angry that he does everything he can to try to destroy your faith and your hope and your walk. That's how the enemy operates. Whenever you get serious. So this week being a big week, Passion Week, and we're getting ready for this play, I know the enemy can't wait to throw things their way. But we're going to do a preemptive strike so that anything that the devil even thought he could try to send this way is already cast down and is cut off at the source. Everybody stretch your hand this way. Father, I thank you for Gerard. I thank you for his life, his confidence, his faith, his faithfulness. I thank you for his gifts, talents, and his abilities, but just his heart to serve. Now we ask that you place a hedge of protection around him this week as he goes in and out, to and fro, wherever he may go. Father, be with him, strengthen him, be with him everywhere he goes, and keep him covered, protected, and safe from all hurt, harm, and danger. We bind the hand of the enemy that would try to send any demonic attacks his way. We cut it off at the root, at the source. We cast it back to the pit of hell, and we speak victory over his life. And we decree and declare that this will be a life of supreme, supernatural focus and hope and joy and strength. Father, when he does this role, let other people be saved and want to be connected to you, oh God. Let people be saved, set free, and delivered as a result of this play this week. We cover him and we cover the entire cast and crew, all the volunteers from the hospitality to the parking lot to security to the ushers, the greeters, everybody who's playing a role in any way, shape, or form. We cover them in the name to which every knee shall bow, the band, the singers, in the name to which every knee shall bow, and in the name to which every tongue shall confess, in the name of Jesus Christ. Somebody shout amen. And come on, give God a praise right here. So just a couple of things before we worship God in our tithe and our offering. This is a big week, and this Sunday kicks off 6 weeks. We're going hard for 6 weeks, hard in the paint for 6 weeks, 6 weeks today. And then, of course, the play this week, and you know about that already. And then next Sunday is Resurrection Sunday. Listen, next Sunday we're doing three services, and we already fill up twice on Sunday. So you already know what Easter Sunday is going to look like. So get here on time and get here. You can't write your name on seat. We're not saving your seat, none of that. I don't know what you need. Maybe you need to spend the night on Saturday and just stay in the parking lot. Hide in the building after the play on Saturday. Just hide in a classroom somewhere. Whatever you need to do to get here. Next Sunday, three services, though, 8 a.m., 9:30 a.m., and 11:30 a.m. 8 a.m., 9:30 a.m., and 11:30 a.m. And then I am so excited about what's coming after that. We're going full steam ahead into celebrating our one-year anniversary. Can you believe it's been a year? One-year anniversary. And to kick it off, I couldn't think of any better person than the person where I learned to preach from. Pastor Steve Lawrence and I were at this church together. Serge was at this church together. And actually, Coach Prime, Deion Saunders, he was there and went through the same minister's class. And that's none other than the one and only Bishop Alfred Owens. He's coming on April the 7th. Bishop Owens is like my preaching hero. Watching him, I learned how to lay out a sermon and how to deliver sermons. I'm going to tell you some funny stories, but I got to tell you the funny stories in front of him. But we'll talk about that when he's here. Again, so I was telling Steve or telling Bishop Owens, text Prime and let him know you're here, because I'm sure he wants to come if he's in town. I'm sure he wants to come to church because he went through Bishop Owens' minister's class. So Bishop Owens will be here on April the 7th. And then, my gosh, my hero, the legendary, the one and only, man, Bishop Marvin L. Winans will be with us on April the 14th. I'm such a hardcore Marvin Winans fan. I mean, Marvin specifically, because BB get it confused. He think I'm one of his fans. I'm like, no. And so, but I'm a hardcore Marvin Winans fan. And even when we talk, even when I call him and he just answers, hello, I'm always like, ah! He does not miss Sundays at his church. He does not miss Sundays. They are actually in the middle of completing a major building campaign, a building that seats 5,000 people. They're in the middle of finishing that. And yet he's taken off on a Sunday to come and be here with us. And so Bishop Marvin Wines. And then on April the 21st, the one and only Bishop Paul Sylvester Martin will be here with us on April the 21st. And so many things. I'm going to tell you guys some very personal stories between me and all three of these guys that make them so special and why it had to be these three. It's not just these three. Let me tell y'all something about me. I don't invite people because they're popular. I invite people because God said, and they are anointed, and they are called for that season. So don't ask me to invite somebody just because they're well known. I don't roll like that. I don't do that at all. And first of all, I got to know you. So I don't invite anybody I don't know. And two, I got to hear that the Lord said that's the man for the or the woman for the hour. And so I'll tell you some personal stories about the three of them and just how much they mean to me when they're here. You don't want to miss any of those Sundays. And then on April the 21st at 6 p.m., that's when we're going to the Hyatt Aurora Denver Conference Center. And we are going to party like it's 1999. At that, well, 2024. You don't miss that. And tickets are $85. I checked the ticket sales just now at my seat, and they've dropped almost 100 since we made the announcement in the 9 a.m. service. And a couple hundred had already been sold. And so, listen, if you're one of those people that you want to wait to the last minute and all that kind of stuff, this is not that. This is one of those things that you need to get on it right now. It is $85 a ticket. $85? Yeah, the hotel costs money. And giving you food selection, you want fish, you want chicken, or you're a vegetarian, that costs money. The concert, the hosting, the DJ, the parking that's included, all those things cost money. And honestly, $85 is nothing these days. I mean, they got that Michael Jackson play coming to the city. That's a couple hundred dollars a ticket. And you go to the movies now and spend $85. You go on vacation. You can't even go on vacation for $85. You go out to dinner now. Take somebody with you. That's more than $85. And so I said at the 9 a.m. service, I said, what's $85 divided by the number of days this church has been good to you over the last year? And I didn't know the number in my head, but when I got to my seat, my father-in-law whispered in my ear. He said, 23 and a half cents a day. 23 and a half cents a day for the last year gets you a ticket to this party. And we're going to have a great, great, great time. And even all of these people, Flex and Shanice and I, we actually did a couple of reality shows together. And our history goes way back. I mean, so far back to where way back in the day, I was actually getting ready to go out on tour with Shanice, playing drums. And that's how far back we go. Shanice was one of our worship leaders at our church. Flex sang in our men's chorus. He gonna tell you about all that. That's some funny stuff right there. But he sang in our men's chorus. Jevin, you probably saw him on the Today Show. You see him in a lot of commercials. So when you see him, you're gonna say, I knew that was him from, we go away. He and his wife were our youth pastors in California. So I have history with everybody. And the young lady standing in the picture with me, I'm married to her. Everybody, I have history with everybody. And so I want you to be a part of that is what I'm saying. So be a part of that. And then on April the 28th, that is our first ever ordination and licensing service and communion service. And so we're going to officially introduce to you our first ever licensed and ordained deacons and deaconess and ministers and pastors and elders here at Hope City Church of Colorado. And I'm excited about that. You definitely want to invite somebody to come and be a part of that as well. Before we worship God in our giving, tomorrow is a very, 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 very special day. Tomorrow, we celebrate the birthday of my mother-in-law on tomorrow. And she is so highly anointed and appointed by God. She has a prophetic word in her mouth. She speaks things into existence. She has an anointing that can bring comfort to your life and direction to your life. I love the fact that she's very direct and loving all at the same time. She has the most anointed hug I've ever experienced of anybody. Let me tell you, if she hugs you, she's going to break you down. So just brace yourself. If she comes your way, just get ready. But I am honored to not just know her, but be blessed enough to call her my mother-in-law. And we were going to take her out to dinner today, but with the weather getting ready to change, you know, everybody's bones start hurting when the weather starts. So we're going to wait. We're going to all go home and lay down today. And then we're going to wait and we're going to do it later. But I wanted to celebrate her birthday now. And I want her to see how many people love her and value her and treasure her and understand the value of family. Would you help me celebrate my mother-in-law's birthday, which is tomorrow? And let her know how much we look forward to her sitting up here and coming out here and being with us. Y'all know I'm big on family. And so we sit up here with our parents for a reason. to show you the foundation of our family. And so we celebrate that birthday happening tomorrow for Elder Marcia Stepter. Again, she's one of the elders in our church. And I thank God for her and her life. Let's worship and celebrate God in our giving. I love to give to God because he first gives to me. Whatever I give to God, I just give a piece of what God has given to me. I am blessed to be a blessing. I'm not blessed to floss and try to look big and show people that I don't need nobody. That's not why I'm blessed. I am blessed to be a blessing. And every time I'm a blessing, God blesses me all over again. The Bible says, here's what I need you to do. Bring the tithe into the church. Now, you can give to nonprofits and organizations, but you can only tithe to the church. Your tithe belongs to the church. And so God says, why do I want you to do that? He says, so that there may be food, is what one version says. But the idea behind that is so the mission and the vision that I've placed on this house can actually happen. It can live on. It can live. It can thrive. Not just survive, but thrive. And the way that happens is the foundation financially is laid through the obedience of the people. And so God says, here's all I want you to do. I want you to, every time you're financially increased, I just want you to take 10% of that and sow that back into the house, into the work and the word of the Lord. He says, if you do that, I'll open up the windows of heaven, pour you out blessing. You don't even have enough room to receive. And I'll rebuke the devourer, the seed stealer, for your sake. And so one scripture says a man's gift makes room for him. And it's literally when you give, doors open for you that you cannot open up all by yourself. I wish that everybody in our church would be in a place with God where they would tithe. But here's what I do ask. Everybody do something. Because I love the fact that God will bless your try. And God will bless your heart. So just start somewhere. If you've never gotten on that giving ladder, just get on. Just take one step on and start somewhere. And then give God the opportunity to at least grow you to where he desires for you to be. But everybody, just make up in your mind, I'm going to do something and I'm a journey with God until God takes me where he wants me to be. When you're ready to give, would you raise that gift high unto the Lord? Raise it high unto the Lord. It's interesting when you talk to people and find out they're tithers. So LL Cool J said he tithes. Denzel Washington, he tithes. I know Chick-fil-A tithes because they ain't even open on Sundays. Here's what get on my nerves, and I love Chick-fil-A, but they don't have, that's it. It's just chicken. And God is just blessing like leaps and bounds. And so tithing works. You want to know why it works? It's a spiritual law. It's a principle. You jump off of this building speaking tongues, you still hit the ground. Why? Because it's a law. I don't care how saved you are. It's a law. So paying tithe is just a law. When you pay your tithes, God blesses you. Again, raise that gift high unto the Lord. Father, we thank you for the opportunity to sow this seed. And we sow it cheerfully, not grudgingly or apprehensive or anything like that, but we sow it cheerfully. It's not a debt we owe. It's a seed we sow in worship and praise and in thanksgiving. As we put this seed in the ground, we look for the promises that we read about in your word to be made manifest in our lives. And so, Father, we stand on your word, trusting you to stand by your word. Take this seed and grow the mission of the church, the vision of the church. Continue to feed our bereavement, our benevolence, our outreach, our children's ministry, our youth ministry. Continue to take this seed and enlarge our territory. But then bless the sower of the seed, because they are the ones who are laying the foundation for where we're headed. So bless the sower of the seed. Give them the desires of their heart. Bless them in every area of their life. Father, we ask that you do exceedingly abundantly above all we could ask or even think. In the name of Jesus Christ, we ask and pray. Somebody shout amen. Amen. You don't have to move. You don't have to walk around. You don't have to do anything. Our ushers are absolutely phenomenal men and women of God. And so they're going to serve you at this time. When that bucket comes in front of you, you can drop that gift in there or take a picture of the QR code on the bucket or just hit send on your phone. Would you help me celebrate and thank God for this worship team as they come back at this time?
Can somebody praise God with the best, with the very best praise that you can give God? Can you clap your hands this morning?
Hallelujah.
It's not for me, it's for him. We're the people that love Jesus this morning, you know. Come on, show some sign if you love him this morning. Come on, everybody on your road should be able to tell that you absolutely love God by you taking a moment to express your love publicly towards him. Come on, somebody bless his name. Bless his name. Bless his name. I'm going to hang out right here. Bless his name. I'm going to hang out right here. Bless his name. Somebody help me bless his name. Somebody in the balcony, help me bless his name. To somebody that he woke up this morning, help me bless his name. Somebody that glad that you got eyes to see, help me bless his name. If you can hear it, somebody say, I just thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you. I got a Thanksgiving in my spirit, y'all, I promise you. It's not that everything going well, but the Bible says in everything give thanks. For this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. So if you're going through something, it's not happening to you, it's happening for you. I wish I had about 200 people that believe that it's not just happening to me, it's happening for me. Hallelujah. 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 There is an authority that's lying deep down inside of you. You're more powerful than you think. You just don't know how to use your weapon. The Bible says that the power of life and death is in your tongue. So when you quiet, you remain defeated. Y'all not talking back to me yet. The more quiet you are, the longer you have to sit in your defeat. But the minute you open your mouth, you release victory in your own life. I guess you said, Brother Steve, where you get that from? I'm glad you asked me. The Bible says that we overcome the adversary by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of our testimony. Look at your neighbor real good. Come on, I need everybody in the room to do it. Because I'm not telling you to look at your neighbor just to incite a riot. But the Bible says we have to touch and agree. That's why I asked you to look at your neighbor. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, guess what God did for me? Well, go ahead and just tell them one thing, one thing, one thing. I can't hear y'all out there. I can't hear you out there. Come on, give me somebody. Look at the other neighbor and say, neighbor. I need somebody over here say, neighbor. Guess what God did for me? Well, go ahead and tell them one thing. Come on, let me hear you testify. Let me hear you testify. Some people just nod their head. You ain't opened your mouth yet. For he is worthy. Can I get 1,000 people to throw your hands up and say, worthy. Nod your head and say, for he is. Come on. Yes, he is good. On the last floor on the balcony, can you throw your hands up and say, for he is worthy. He's worthy. Come on, I need somebody to jump to the feet and say, for he is good. Good God Almighty. Yes, he is good. One more time. Come on, the whole building. Hope City. Hope City. Throw your hands up right here. I said, for he is worthy. the roof right here. Come on, y'all. No, he did not. Y'all gotta warn your first-time guests before they come here. Girl, he might say anything. Matthew chapter 21, verse 1. Matthew chapter 21, verse 1. Now, when they drew near Jerusalem and came to Bethphage at the Mount of Olives, then Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, go into the village opposite you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied and a colt with her. Loose them and bring them to me. And if anyone says anything to you, you shall say the Lord has need of them. And immediately he will send them. All this was done that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by the prophet, saying, tell the daughter of Zion, behold, your king is coming to you, lowly and sitting on a donkey, a colt, the foal of a donkey. So the disciples went and did as Jesus commanded them. They brought the donkey and the colt, laid their clothes on them, and set him on them. And a very great multitude spread their clothes on the road. Others cut down branches from the trees and spread them on the road. Then the multitudes who went before and those who followed cried out, saying, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. And when he had come into Jerusalem, all the city was moved, saying, who is this? So the multitude said, this is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth of Galilee. I want to talk from the subject for the next few moments, what victory looks like.
what victory looks like. Right out of the gate, I want you to notice that the arrival of Jesus instantly divides the crowd into three categories. You have the postured, those that spread their clothes and branches out on the road. They had a posture of worship. You have the pleased, those that began to cry out, Hosanna. They were ready and pleased to praise him. Then you have the perplexed. Those were the ones who were confused and asked, who is he? And I've discovered that whenever the Holy Spirit shows up, you will either be postured to worship, pleased to praise him, or perplexed with questions. I've also discovered that the questions begin to fade as you grow in your knowledge and confidence of who God is. This knowledge and confidence starts with understanding that God has always lived and operated in eternal victory. Eternal meaning no beginning and no end. God's victory does not have a start date. And it does not have an end date. His victory always was and always will be. His victory is forever. His victory has always existed, is always existing, and will always exist. And everything he created was also designed to live and operate in victory. Because everything he created was created from a place of victory. Unfortunately, the devil thought he was what God is, and as a result, lost the victory. He and everybody who sided with him. The devil then made it his mission to try and steal what you still possess. You have to understand that you don't fight for victory, you fight from victory. Oh, God, help me here. If you fought for victory, the devil wouldn't need to attack you because you would not have what he wants. However, because you fight from victory, he attacks you because you already have what he's trying to regain. And subconsciously, you know that. That's the reason why you say, the devil is trying to steal my joy. Not trying to steal the joy, because there's not a joy out there that the devil and I are racing to see who can get to first. He's trying to steal what I already have. He's trying to steal my peace, not the peace, not a peace that's out there that he's trying to beat me to, but he's trying to steal what I already have. Oh, God, help me preach this here. You don't realize that the thing you've been looking for, you've been walking around with the whole time. Oh, God, help me slow down. I wish Dorothy and the Scarecrow and the Tin Man and the Lion were here to help me preach this. Because the Scarecrow would tell you that the whole time I was looking for a brain, I was the one thinking of ways out of the situation. The Lion would say the whole time I was looking for courage, I was the one fighting out of the situations. The Tin Man would say the whole time I was looking for a heart, I was the one showing the most compassion. A T. Somebody said, what version is that? That's the Wiz. Don't you carry nothing. That might be a load. Moses, stretch out what's already in your hand. You don't realize you're already walking around. What about you, Dorothy? What about you? Dorothy would say, I didn't realize that what I needed was on my feet the whole time. Just click them together and say, there's no place like home. And so what you're looking for, you already have. And so because you have what the devil wants, let me expose his game plan. Let me show you his strategy. Here is the devil's game plan. His game plan is to limit your perception of victory to your possession of things. He wants you to think that victory is a house. Victory is a spouse. Victory is a car. Victory is a job. Victory is promotion. But I came here this morning to remind you that victory is not the possession of things. Victory is the possession of Christ and the knowledge of your identity in Christ. See, the problem is when you limit victory to things, you destroy the potential for growth in your discernment. You destroy the potential for growth in your discipline, in your discretion, and in your decision making. And as long as the enemy can limit your perception and definition of victory to things, then he can cause you to miss the multiple ways in which victory shows up. The text is laced with victory. But because we don't read about people falling down dead, falling on the sword, being overcome with some disease, or because we don't read about someone who stepped into some form of material gain, we can easily miss it if we read it too fast. But God sent me here this morning to show you what victory looks like in four areas of the text. And the hope-filled news is that it's the same four areas that all of us experience time and time again throughout our lives. Matthew says that Jesus now said to two disciples. Why? Why two? Why not one? Why two disciples? Because he wants to remind us that we were not created to do anything all by ourselves. We were not created to do anything solo. We were created to work with each other. It is the trick of the enemy to make you think that you don't need anybody. The devil is a lie. You are but a beautiful piece of God's bigger puzzle. And so everybody needs somebody. That's the reason why you better be careful how you treat people, because the same people you step on your way up, you're going to need their help on your way back down. So he says to two of them, because we're supposed to work together. Jesus says to them, go to the village which is opposite of them. Hear me good. Don't be alarmed when God gives you instructions that are in the opposite direction of where you are, or in the opposite direction of where you were headed. We serve a God that knows how to send you in the other direction. He says, when you get there, you'll find a donkey and a colt tied. Loose them and bring them to me. And if anyone questions you, tell them that I need them. And that sums up, ladies and gentlemen, the first area of victory. This is the area that I call preparation. Write this down, because this is my first point. Victory looks like preparation. But I want you to pay close attention to what preparation looks like. During this preparation phase, Jesus gave them a very specific assignment. And it's during your season of preparation that you will receive your divine assignment. When it seems like God has you waiting, and it seems like God has you going through cycles and different scenarios, but not necessarily moving forward yet, it's because he's downloading inside of you his divine assignment for your life. And watch this. Part of their assignment was to untie the donkey and the colt. In other words, to loose what was bound. And during your season of preparation, God will free you from some things that tried to keep you bound. I want you to notice, though, that the donkey and the colt could not untie themselves. They needed the help of the disciples. And during your season of preparation, God will send people to do for you what you cannot do for yourself. Oh, it's going to get good in a minute. The fact that the donkey and the colt could not untie themselves tells me that Jesus knows how to come get you wherever you are. Because the donkey and the colt were stuck. Oh, I'm trying not to get ahead of myself, but look at your neighbor and say, but you won't be stuck forever. The donkey and the colt were restricted, but you won't be restricted forever. The donkey and the colt were bound, but I declare in the name of Jesus, you won't be bound forever. They could not get to Jesus, but Jesus could get to them. And I came to tell somebody this morning who feels stuck emotionally, stuck spiritually, stuck psychologically, stuck physically, and you say, I cannot move from this place to get to Jesus. All Jesus needs you to do is stay right where you are. Because when you can't get to Jesus, Jesus can sure enough get to you. Just stay there. Ooh, I didn't say this at the 9, but I feel the Holy Ghost telling me to say it at the 11. You're not so much stuck as you are being preserved. Because when the other disciples wrote about it, Jesus told them, go and get the donkey and the colt on which nobody has ever sat on before. In other words, God is keeping you safe in a place that you feel bound and stuck in just so you won't get used by the wrong person. But when he comes, oh, I feel the Holy Ghost right there. But when he comes to get you, he's going to break you out and break you out to be used not just by anybody, but by Jesus Christ himself. You ain't stuck, you preserved. You gotta stay right where you are. You can't leave yet. You can't run yet, because God is keeping you from some dangers you don't even know about. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, I'm not stuck, I'm being preserved. So now, when you feel like you can't get to him, rest assured knowing, even when you don't feel like you can get to him, he can always get to you. Then Jesus says to them, when you get there, if anybody questions you, here's what you say. It is during the preparation phase that God equips you with how to deal with opposition. And the way he equips them, help me, Holy Ghost, the way he equips them is he says, let me put my words in your mouth. When you get there and they try to stop you, say what I'm about to say to you right now. See, with a whole Bible in front of you, you never have to make up your own responses. All you got to do is read your Bible and say what God says about you and declare the promises of the Lord over your life. So now, by the time you leave the preparation phase, you sound more like Jesus. He said, all I need you to do is just repeat what I say. If you just repeated what Jesus said to you to say to yourself, you'll be walking around saying, I'm more than a conqueror. I'm an overcomer. I am victorious. I am a survivor. Listen, and so by the time you leave the preparation phase, you sound more like Jesus. You act more like Jesus. And you look more like Jesus. Matthew then walks us out of the area of preparation and into another area where victory is revealed. He reminds us now that Zechariah 9:9 says, behold, your king is coming to you, lowly and sitting on a donkey, a colt, the foal of a donkey. Which brings me to my second point, and you got to write this down. Just like victory looks like preparation, here's point number 2. Victory looks like prophecy. See, here's what the devil does not want you to know. God is currently unfolding promises that he spoke over your life before he formed you in your mother's womb. Not only promises that he spoke over your life, but promises that he spoke to and through generations that have come before you. You may not realize it, but you are still here because God promised somebody in your lineage that he would protect their descendants and their descendants' descendants. And you are walking under that promise. You are still here because God made a covenant with your great-great-grandmother or your great-great-grandfather, and he promised that he would keep everybody that came in their lineage. And so you survive what you survive because God made a promise to somebody you never even met. Not only are you walking under a promise, but you're walking with confirmation. Hear me good. If you just slow your life down, if you slow your life down long enough and just think about your life, the events of your life, God is giving you plenty of confirmations that he is with you. You may say, Pastor, I don't see it because I've always been broke. But you're missing it because you're limiting it to things. But the fact that you've been broke with a cell phone. It's confirmation right there that God has given you confirmation that he will keep you even when you don't have any money. If we just took a moment to look back over our lives, there's some people in the room and online, you had belly full with no food left over in the refrigerator. If you would slow your life down, there's some people in the room, you can say, I've had my bills paid with no money in the bank. Healing in my body with no insurance, let alone a primary care physician. Made it to your destination with no gas in the tank. A roof over your head while behind on your rent. A car to drive while behind on your payments. Pastor, what do you call that? You call that a fulfillment of a prophetic promise. And it's a prophetic promise that sounds like the words of Jesus in Matthew 28:20, when Jesus told his disciples, lo, I'm with you always, even to the end of the age. It sounds like Isaiah 41:10, where the Bible says, fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. Yes, I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. It sounds like Deuteronomy 31:8. And the Lord, he is the one who goes before you. He will be with you. He will not leave you nor forsake you. Do not fear nor be dismayed. It sounds like Exodus 14:14. The Lord will fight for you and you shall hold your peace. It sounds like Isaiah 43:2. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And through the rivers, they shall not overflow you. When you walk through the fire, you shall not be burned, nor shall the flame scorch you. It sounds like Joshua 1:9. Have I not commanded you? Be strong and of good courage. Do not be afraid, nor be dismayed, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. It sounds like Philippians 4:19. And my God shall supply all of my needs according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. Victory looks like a prophetic promise. So grab hold to a prophetic promise and hold up your head, square your shoulders, get your joy back, your peace back, your smile back, your laugh back, your praise back, your worship back, and act like you got victory. Victory looks like prophecy. Victory looks like confirmation. Matthew then has walked us through the area of preparation. He's then walked us through the area of prophecy. And now he informs us that the disciples brought back the donkey and the colt. Interesting, because of all the people that write about it, Matthew is the only person who brought up the donkey and the colt. Everybody else just talks about the colt. But Matthew is the only person that says, hey, don't you dare leave out that donkey. It was a donkey and a colt. Matthew, why would you include the donkey and the colt? Because, Pastor Marlon, I'm trying to support the idea, the statement you made earlier, that everybody deserves and everybody needs companionship. So you can't have the donkey without the colts. Because everybody needs somebody. They threw their clothes on the donkey. They threw their clothes on the colt. Why? Because everybody needs a covering. You need somebody around you who knows how to cover you. Somebody who knows how to pray for you. Somebody who knows how to fight for you. And I'm not talking about naturally, I'm talking about spiritually. You need somebody that knows how to fight for you in prayer. Somebody that says, I'm fasting for you. I'm believing God for you. I'm praying for you. I know God's got me. Because I know God's got me, I'm going on a fast for what God's getting ready to do for you. You need somebody that knows how to cover you in prayer and cover you in fasting. They threw their clothes on the donkey. They threw their clothes on the colt. Then Jesus sat on them. Why? Because everybody needs some comfort. Look at your neighbor and say, don't feel bad when you just need a little bit of comfort. Jesus obviously did not ride them both at the same time. He more than likely rode one in the beginning and one at the end. But be assured that Jesus is going to use everybody. And just like the donkey had a turn, and just like the colt had a turn, everybody has a responsibility to take Jesus to the people. And you better believe there comes a point in your life where God is going to depend on you to take him to the people around you. That's, I feel the Holy Ghost. That's the reason why you cannot get the new job yet. because somebody is on their way to hell on your current job, and God needs you to show up and take Jesus to one more coworker. See, you think it's about a paycheck. It ain't about a paycheck, because you came here with nothing. You're going to leave here with nothing. The only thing you're going to leave here with is your relationship with Jesus Christ. It ain't about a paycheck. It's about connecting people to Jesus. So you cannot get promoted until God says it's time to get promoted, and God says it's time to get promoted, not when your boss is satisfied, but when God is satisfied that you have completed not your natural assignment, but your spiritual assignment. Somebody needs you to stay 3 more weeks so that they can know how good God is in their life. Because every promotion that happens doesn't come from an employer anyway. It comes from God. Because there's always somebody better qualified than you. But when God looks at you and says, your assignment is done at this job, then he'll move you to the next job. And you think it's just an answer to my prayer. It's the fulfillment of an assignment. That's the reason why you can't move out of the neighborhood yet. That's the reason why you can't do certain things yet. Because your spiritual assignment is not done. Somebody who won't even let you know they're looking at you, they're looking at you. And they know your story. And they're looking at you saying, if you can hold on, I know I can hold on. Ooh, can I tell y'all something crazy? I never told this story publicly. I don't think they're watching, so it's okay. This is terrible. This is terrible. So at our church in California, God gave me a word. There was a guy who was a boxer at our church. He was a boxer. And church was high that Sunday. I mean, we were going all the way, just all the way in. You know how we do at the 11 o'clock. Just go all the way there. We church so hard, we need a nap after the 11 o'clock. Y'all know how we get down. I see how y'all leave. Everybody going to the parking lot like, whew. Holding your heels, holding the straps. Whew. Girl, pastor, something else. Well, that boy be wearing me out, thank you, in the parking lot. So we were having church like that, and I called out this boxer. I said, come here. I said, God says that you haven't fought in over a year, but get ready. You got a fight coming up. Get ready, and God's going to do it. And he had no fights on the book. God's going to do it. God's going to restore you. God's going to do it. Okay. So he came back the next Sunday. He said, pastor, I got booked for a fight this week. Now, can I give y'all something that I learned the hard way? When God stops talking, you stop talking too. I didn't know that then. So when he told me, I got happy. And I said, oh! And I hear God say, there's going to be a knockout. Wait, just give me a second. Get ready, because you ain't never seen a knockout this fast. You ain't never seen what God's getting ready to do. And I told the whole church, make sure you pay for the fight, because he's representing God. And then they're going to have somebody that represents the devil, and God's going to show you what he's going to do to the devil. Everybody, spend your money and get it on pay-per-view. It's worth it.
We flew to Vegas. One of the guys that served on security with me, he was a boxing trainer, and I paired him with this boxer to train him. We all in Vegas. 15,000 people. And we there. How you doing? Hey, how you? God bless you. How you doing? I go up to the front row. His wife is like, pastor, you prophesied this. I said, you better believe I did. She said, pastor, you saw this day. I said, help! Don't you start nothing in this arena. Introduced her husband, introduced the other fighter. She said, this is going to be good. While we are talking, she and I, we hear, while we're talking, ding, boom, boom. Oh! I looked up. I said, is that your husband? He tried to get up. I didn't know if he was like apologizing to the other boxer or just wanted to hug him in the moment. I don't know. He fell into him, and the other boxer just said, gah. And he went back down, and they counted him all the way out. Done. Quickest knockout I ever seen.
His wife took her VIP backstage pass off and put it on my neck. She said, "That's on you." I went to the back. And I heard him. Now, he just got the brakes beat off of him. I mean, he got whooped. Like, pow, pow, pow. I was like, ah, that was too hard. He's in the back going, "Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus." This other guy back there came out and said, "Bro, can I tell you something?" He said, "Man, I was so mad at God." He said, "Because I was a former NBA player." He said, "I messed up my knee and I couldn't play anymore. And I took it all out on God." He said, "But when I watched you out there tonight and I saw you just get whooped and beat." And I mean, that guy, I'm like, "We get it, man." He said, "After what you went through, if you can get up from that and praise God, then I can drop my whole attitude and give God my life back too." I'm trying to say, as hard as it is for you to recover, somebody is looking at you currently recovering, and because you are in the middle of recovering, they gonna trust God again. You never know who's watching you. Watch this be the one service he watched. You got the older donkey, you got the younger colt, which tells me that Jesus is relevant in every generation. Matthew now says that Jesus began to proceed into town. Give me 10 minutes and I'm almost done. He says Jesus began to proceed into town. Let me tell you why that's a big deal. Let me tell you why that's mega. Because Jesus proceeded knowing problems lay ahead. He proceeded knowing problematic people lay ahead. He proceeded knowing there were people who hated him ahead. He proceeded knowing there were people who wanted him dead ahead. He proceeded knowing there were people who didn't believe him ahead. He proceeded knowing there were people lying on him ahead. He proceeded knowing there were people who would misuse him ahead. He proceeded knowing there were people who would abuse him ahead. But in spite of it all, he proceeded forward. And in his processing forward, he shows us, and here's number three, victory looks like procession. Oh, God, help me. It looks like preparation. It looks like prophecy, but it looks like procession. Victory looks like you moving forward even when it doesn't look good. It looks like you moving forward even when it doesn't feel good. It looks like you moving forward even when it doesn't sound good. Victory looks like you moving forward even when you know there's some people who just simply don't like you. Victory looks like you moving forward even when you know opposition is trying to stop you. Victory looks like you moving forward even when you don't have all the answers. Victory looks like you moving forward even when you don't have all the resources. Victory looks like you moving forward even when it looks like the pain is coming before the promise. Victory looks like you moving forward even when it feels chaotic, even when it feels messy, even when it feels uncomfortable. Your moving forward is what victory looks like. Moving forward while reminding yourself that weeping may endure for night, but joy is coming in the morning. That's what victory looks like. It looks like you moving forward while reminding yourself that no weapon formed against you is going to prosper. That's what victory looks like. It looks like you moving forward while reminding yourself that you can do all things through Christ because he strengthens you. And I came to tell about 600 people in this service that every step forward is a step of victory. Every smile is a smile of victory. Every clap is a clap of victory. Every shout is a shout of victory. So keep moving forward, because moving forward is what victory looks like. I'm almost done, but now I need your help. Look at your neighbor and say, "Neighbor, keep putting one foot in front of the other, because every step you take is a step of victory. Every clap you do is a clap of victory. Every time you smile is a smile of victory. Every time you shout is a shout of victory." The devil wants you to throw in the towel. The devil wants you to back away. The devil wants you to say, "I can't do it anymore." But what the devil does not know is I got something that's functioning on the inside of me that acts like an energizer bunny. It keeps me going and going and going and going. I take a licking, but I keep on ticking. Keep putting your clothes on. Keep getting in the car. Keep showing up. Keep running your errands. Keep praying. Keep prophesying. Keep believing. Keep hanging in there. And then what Matthew does is Matthew takes his final moments and ushers us out of this area of procession. And Matthew shows us that there were people in the crowd who had a praise. And you better believe some people in the crowd, life was not going good, but they still had a praise. There were some people in the crowd who were experiencing a rough time, yet they were praising God. There were some people in the crowd who were broke, yet they were praising God. There were some people in the crowd in the middle of an internal fight, yet they were praising God. There were some people in the crowd who were in the middle of an external fight, yet they were praising God. And the fact that Matthew shows us the praises of the people reveals a fourth area where victory looks like. Victory looks like preparation. Victory looks like prophecy. Victory looks like procession. But I came to tell you this morning that victory looks like praise. That's the reason why I made up in my mind that I will bless the Lord at all times. His praises shall continually be in my mouth. And whatever you do, don't let anybody, don't let anything steal your praise, because there's victory in your praise. There's healing in your praise. There's joy in your praise. There's triumph in your praise. Make up in your mind that I'm going to do what I was created to do. I was created to praise God. So don't wait until you feel like it. Do it because that's why you were created. I might be a policeman, but I was created to praise. I might be a fireman, but I was created to praise. I might be a preacher, but I was created to praise. I might be a doctor, but I was created to praise. And you came here with nothing. You leave here with nothing. But the one thing you're going to take is your relationship with God. So I might as well bless the Lord, oh my soul, and all that's within me. Can I have five more minutes? I got to put a good bow on this thing. Shake your neighbor's hand and say, neighbor, there's power in your praise. I know you're going through some battles, but praise God. I know it's not easy, but praise God, because your biggest weapon is not your bank account. Your biggest weapon is not your credit report. Your biggest weapon is not your degree. Your biggest weapon is your praise. Your biggest weapon. The devil don't care about your doctrine. The devil don't care about your 6,000 square foot house. The devil don't care about your brand new SUV. But when you praise God, the devil has to pack his bags and flee. Because God says, when you praise me, I show up in the middle of your praise. Yet will I praise him. Broke but a praise. Unemployed but got a praise. No car but got a praise. At home but got a praise. Bills unpaid but got a praise. Behind on rent but got a praise. Look at your neighbor and tell your neighbor, you can't steal my joy. You can't steal my praise. I wish my father was here, because my father would tell you. He used to tell me, praise him in the morning. Praise him in the noonday. Praise him when the sun goes down. But wait a minute, y'all. I'm going to let you go in a minute. But can I tell you this? Do you remember in the beginning of the sermon, I said to you in the beginning that God has eternal victory. That means it's eternal. It's no beginning and it's no end. I threw that statement out there and I'm glad you received it. But let me take the text and prove my statement that God has eternal victory. When we talked about prophecy, we were talking about the past. When we talked about preparation, we were talking about the present. When we talked about procession, we were talking about the future. And that entire time, right under our noses, God was building the case that there is victory in your past. Shake your neighbor's hand and say, neighbor, I got victory in my past. That's why drugs couldn't kill me. That's why alcohol couldn't kill me. That's why suicide couldn't kill me. That's why I made it out of bondage and made it out of abuse and made it out of misuse, because there was victory in my past. I showed up to let you know that when the devil meant for evil, God has turned it around for your good. And everything that reached for you did not reach you. You are a survivor of your past. You are a conqueror of your past. Look at your shouting. Look at your praising. Look at your magnifying. And the same God that brought you out of your past is the same God that's keeping you in your present. You don't know like I know what God is still doing for me right now. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, he's currently keeping me. He's currently protecting me. He's currently bringing me out. Because I got the same victory that was in my past is in my present. But help me out, David, while I close the sermon. I'll help you out, Pastor Marlon. If victory is not limited to your past, victory is not limited to your present. But David said, the Lord is my shepherd. Not I have not wanted, not I do not want, but based on what is already done, coupled with what is currently doing, David said, I'm stepping over into my future. I'm prophesying on my future, and I declare in the name of Jesus, the Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. Look at your neighbor one more time and say, neighbor, I won't be broke. I won't be lonely. I won't be suicidal. I shall not want. I shall not die like this. I shall not be defeated. Because victory is in my future. When I was a little boy, they taught me a song that said, victory is mine. Victory is mine. Victory today is mine. I told Satan, get thee behind. Because victory today is mine. I gotta let y'all go. But victory on my job. Victory in my home. Victory in my body. Victory in my heart. Victory in my mind. Victory in the car. Victory when I go to bed. Victory when I get up. Victory when I get dressed. Victory when I go to work. Victory in my body. Victory in my credit. Victory in my finances. Victory in my son. Victory in my daughter. Victory in my mother. Victory in my father. Victory everywhere. I sleep victory. I eat victory. I wear victory. I drive victory. I walk victory. I talk victory. God bless y'all this morning. Happy Palm Sunday to you. Somebody, anybody, everybody, give God a prayer. Oh, wait. I forgot to tell you this. I forgot to tell you this. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, so do you want to know what victory looks like? I'm what victory looks like. I am victory. I am an overcomer. I am a survivor. I am a winner. I am a conqueror. I am a survivor. I am victory. Everybody in this room, we get ready to go home, but you got victory. I declare you got victory in every area of your life. I wish Oprah was here, because Oprah would say, you got victory, 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 you got victory. Shake your neighbor's hand and say, I got it. Yes, I got it. Yes, I got it.
Everybody stand, let's go home.
Woo! Hey!
We better go home, we better go home. And so, Father, hey! Just look at your neighbor with confidence and say, I got it, baby, I got it. You standing next to victory, I got it, I got it. Father, we thank you. We honor you. We magnify you. We adore you. We appreciate you. We ask now that you take us from this place. But whatever you do, don't take us from your presence. I want everybody on this Palm Sunday to repeat this prayer after me. It doesn't matter if this is your first time praying it or you pray it every day or first time in a long time. Everybody repeat after me. Dear Heavenly Father, I confess with my mouth, I believe in my heart that Jesus Christ died on the cross for my sin. I confess with my mouth, I believe in my heart that you raised Jesus from the dead. So I accept, I receive Jesus Christ as my personal Lord, my personal Savior. I declare that I still have victory. And I declare old things have passed away and all things have become new through Christ Jesus, in the name of Jesus. Now, Father, take us from this place, but whatever you do, don't take us from your presence. Keep us and cover us and bring us back at the appointed time, ready to praise, worship, and honor you together in Jesus' mighty name. Somebody shout amen. Would you hug somebody close to you and tell them victory is yours? Victory is yours. Next Sunday, 8, 9:30, 11:30. Get those tickets for that gala and meet us here at the play Friday, 7 p.m., Saturday, 2 p.m. and 7 p.m. God bless you.